We continue with a panel discussion coordinated by Mr. Nicholas Karidis of Ampersand Public Affairs. Participating in the discussion are Alex Aiken, Stephen Welsh, Robert Orchard, Eleonora Gavrilidis, and Maria Kikida. Mrs. Kikida is a communication and media manager at the British Embassy in Athens.
Colleagues, I think it's been a really interesting debate, but we are running because we have had some fascinating debates. And those of you who are on Twitter will see that I've tweeted the Government Communications Service social media guidance and the Government Communications Service code of ethics, given that was part of the very robust debate we had earlier. But we have got to close up fairly quickly. We can't go on, otherwise we'll miss lunch and miss other appointments and so on. So I've got a proposal for you. It involves you as the audience. I want you to have a conversation with the person next to you, or if you don't like the person next to you, the person behind you, if they're a bit ugly or smelly, the person in front of you, it's up to you. Just find someone to have a chat with about what you've heard this morning, and then I'm going to pick some questions from the audience. I'm going to ask our panel to respond to it, and if you've got about 2 minutes to have that discussion, and then I'm going to pick on you, so you might not escape, even if you want to, so you better have a question, and we'll go to the panel, and then Nikos will conclude, I believe. Okay, over to you.
As though you've stolen my role.
Well, I just think it's a way of getting through.
I agree. Otherwise we, I agree. Let me. Can you give me a minute, Amaria? Yeah. Can I just put something in order, yeah. Make some introductions, and then we can hobble on.
You're going to go on, because otherwise we'll.
Okay.
I'll hand back to you, and you do the introductions.
Okay, fine.
What are you to introduce the three?
No, I was just going to introduce Maria. Well, the feedback that we had from the earlier panel was that a lot of the people wanted to ask questions, but we didn't have the time. So it is an opportunity for them to do that. Yeah, certainly.
Θα έρθω κοντά σου σε κάποια στιγμή για να πεις εκείνο το οποίο έχεις να πεις.
All right, I'm going to hand back to our chair, who's going to introduce the panel, and then I will pick out some questions. Over to you.
Okay. Well, you've thrown me off my track a bit, Alex, but thank you anyway. First of all, we need to thank our previous speakers for their expert insight, including yours.
Yeah.
We should try to keep this as informal as possible, as you suggested. And I'll allow our panelists to perhaps comment or perhaps choose to give emphasis on something that they had heard from before or during the panel discussion. And if there is something that you need to say, by all means, from what you've heard, I need to introduce only Maria Kikida, who's the only person you haven't been introduced to. She is the communications and media manager at the British Embassy in Athens. If I give you like a few seconds to say what you want to say, and then we can throw it to the audience. Okay. Yeah?
Thank you, Nicola. Please allow me just one phrase in Greek. Ως Ελληνίδα είναι βαθιά συγκίνηση να βρίσκομαι στο Προεδρικό σήμερα. Το λέω από καρδιάς, το εννοώ και σας ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ για την τιμή. Switch back to English. 20 years ago I joined the press office of the British Embassy in Athens, straight off Kitchen Garden, you can tell, and as a press reader. In 2004, we are the comms team, which gives you an idea of how our role has changed in response of a changing environment. What we're doing in Athens, we're doing traditional media work. We're doing digital, public diplomacy, campaigning, crisis comms. We are basically doing government communications abroad, cross-government communications, by default it is. Embassies represent the whole of the government, not just the FCO. So to a large extent, we're looking after and promote the UK brand in Greece. So we know how important cohesive, coordinated and seamless comms is, the kind of comms Alex described in his introduction. And just a word about tools. We're doing government comms as a part of a comprehensive comms strategy, which attempts to use the right mix of tools in order to build and deliver the relevant messages to the targeted audiences. And at the same time, we go to where the discussion is, online and offline, listen to concerns, listen to trends, and engage in the conversation. That's for me.
Thank you, Maria.
All right, thank you. So I'm going to take some questions from the audience. I'll hand back to the chair, and the chair can decide who answers the really difficult questions and who, like Robert, gets the easier questions. Right, I started the morning with colleagues from the foreign press side of the government information service. What were you discussing just now?
Hello. We're just discussing the role of a government press officer in the new era. From what we've heard here today, there were a couple of things. In a way, we are a bridge as press officers of the government between a lot of things, actually. The government itself, the officials, the journalists who are trying to do their job to convey the messages and to get the messages from the public and bring them back. So in this sense, because we've heard some complaints, some comments, some negative things, we would like to hear, to be more concrete, more precise, and be practical, and hear from the press community what they need to have from us to enable us to do our job better. And then on the other hand, we would like the government officials to listen to us in the sense that we are more sensitive to the needs of the press, and sometimes it is hard to get the message across to the officials about what the press people need. So, to my mind, this has a lot to do with the way the messages are come across, the methods, the tools we use, the tools we need, the speed of things, which has changed, because it is some. I mean, I'm not going to get personal here, but sometimes it is hard to accept that we submit a request for an interview for a journalist, for example, and we only get an answer after we have called them 4, 5, 6, 7 times. And sometimes written answers come to from a ministry. I had this experience. I filed a written request for an answer to a specific journalist question, and I got an answer 7 months later from a ministry. So this, for me, is unacceptable. And I would like to hear how these things can be overcome.
Very good question. I'll take 3 from this side and 3 from the other side.
First of all, thank you for a most informative and interesting morning. My question relates more to what Mr. Orchard has said. First of all, I worked for some years, but that was in the past, for the Cyprus News Agency. Now, being a member of the public rather than a journalist in the Cyprus News Agency, I don't know whether the news reported, I would receive it as information, but I know, and I don't know whether this still exists, I believe it does. It never questions or criticizes anything that any government ever does. So it's more like an agency that reports on what politicians say without any sense of criticism or questioning what they say. The second question is, in Cyprus is very small, and almost everybody knows everybody, and people, especially journalists and politicians, have close relations. How could I, as a member of the public, trust a journalist, a political correspondent, who has been switching back and forth from being a journalist to being a spokesperson for a politician, especially during an election campaign, and then back to journalism, and whether this is ethically right?
Again, another good question. Right, final one of the three.
I think actually that's a good bridge for what I wanted to comment, is that part of the problem is, and I'm a journalist, part of the problem is that readers and viewers don't punish us. When we mess up, when we hide stories, when we cover up because we do have that cozy relationship, you know what happens next? We still sell papers. We still get viewers and we still get advertising. So we really don't care. The public doesn't punish bad reporting the way neoliberal economics would predict it would. It just doesn't. But I think the discussion since this morning has brought up, in my mind, a fundamental sort of tension between journalism and actual briefing. And that's one of the problems that we have in Cyprus. Official sources that are supposed to give you hard, cold data don't quite work, or they work very, very, very slowly. Just 2 weeks ago, we had a Eurostat revision of Cypriot GDP by almost 10%, and there was not a single press release about it. We figured it out because we realized GDP is suddenly much, much higher. And that's the only sort of information we had. We had to call up the statistical service to figure out what's going on. On the other hand, the relationship and the coziness with politicians, again, works sometimes the other way around. In my experience, the harder you hit them, the more access they give you, so you'll shut up. So sometimes it works nicely that way. But again, I think without political press officers who will give you a briefing rather than numbers and information and the official line, there's nothing more certain in my personal experience. No way is more certain to get you really, really bad press, at least for me and several others, than asking for a comment from a politician and getting what we call the poem, the official line. You know what? I'm not going to cover you the way you want. When you're giving me that, what is the benefit for my readers? And they don't care. So, I mean, that fundamental tension, I think, is worth noting.
Passionate. Good question. All right. Three challenges. Back to you.
Well, it all seems to raise questions of trust, the trust to the news organization, the trust to the politicians and the state. There's also the question of news and the flow of news. It is no longer one occasion, one event. The agenda, the news agenda may be changing two or three times within a day and following that up. So I'll throw it to you and see whether we can perhaps provide some questions. I don't know if Eleonora, you want to start on the public trust side of it, and how does the state and the government regain that? And then we go to Robert in terms of the media.
We are in a state of transition.
Maybe, do you want to exchange that?
This one's working. Okay. Yes, this one's working. We are in state communications, government communications are in a state of transition. As I was trying to say today, what the picture I was trying to paint was where we need to go. Because if you think the life of the Cyprus Republic is not that long, we started as just spokespeople of the government, churning out the official story. Now we are seeing, and I agree very much with Konstantinos Pieridis, that part, the political part, sort of representing the government politically, is not our main job. If we have to do it, yes, we need to be trained to be spokespeople, we can do it, but I agree with Alex in that case, we will not attack the opposition as government officials. Therefore, if they need this part, the political part, they need to solve it another way. And we need to be more and more geared to what society generally wants, not to deal just with political news, economic news, giving information about this, and media relations. We need to open up. We need to be much more involved with public debate, facilitating the people to be heard. And so we are reorganizing to work that way. Mm-hmm. But We definitely need more political empowerment to do that. This has to be recognized that this is our role or our main role from now on. It doesn't mean that you don't put out press releases. It doesn't mean that you don't do media relations. We do, it's our role. But it's not the whole anymore. And it is a continuum, it's a process, which we have embarked on. We're definitely not at the goalpost yet.
But can I just say, before the government spokesman said that he read the comments under various articles that he saw posted. So in a sense, he's getting the feeling of the public. Are you as the PIO, as a communication agency, also reading these comments to understand what you mentioned before as being your target audience, the public at large?
Are
you absorbing what is being said, and does that define an agenda?
In an unstructured and uncoordinated way. What I think is we need to do it much more, with much more direction, and be much more focused.
Okay. Maria, can I just turn to you before I go to Robert? In terms of the flowing news agenda, in Greece you have, as in Cyprus, we have an economic crisis. There is an institutional crisis as well because there is no trust. But you have conflicting news coming from Brussels, from Frankfurt, and what is being said by the governments in the capitals. How do you deal with all that is going on, the cacophony of news, and how do you manage to filter out what is actually the truth, what is reliable and credible information? And I'm asking you in terms of your contact with the media in Greece and how they perceive it.
It's difficult, I won't lie. It's difficult to make sense of it. The key to this is follow the agenda 24/7, basically, and listen to all different sides. And trying to get to the bottom of an argument, trying to get to the facts before you start reading the reaction and before you start reading the comments, and you know, as regards the crisis, as you said, you know, that there were actual facts that we needed to follow and understand. So getting this right first, and then trying to figure to map out the reaction, let's say.
Okay. Do you report back to London what the social media in Greece says?
Yes. Nowadays, reporting back to London, media reporting includes social media as well. Yes. Yeah.
Okay. I'm conscious of the question that Maria asked about the Cyprus News Agency, and also the question of journalists switching to PR and then going back to journalism. I'm at a loss as to how one can answer that question. It's just part of the way that modern media and public affairs operate. But I think it's a valid issue. I don't know whether any other of our panelists would dare to.
Personally, I think it's a major question. And I would never trust a journalist that has been a spokesperson.
Especially a spokesperson during an election period. I cannot understand how can you can be a government spokesman and then appear as an independent journalist. That, to my mind, is...
I think Mr. Orchard will dare to answer.
Well, I'll comment on various points. But on that point, presumably you understand how a barrister can defend a murderer and how they can, whether they think someone's innocent or guilty, they can be independent. Journalists have to cover all sorts of stories where they may have an individual view, even a political view, but they keep to themselves. But it's quite possible to take a political detachment from that, a professional detachment from whatever your individual views are. Depends how quickly people are flipping and flopping and how often. I mean, it's quite common. I can think of lots of people in the BBC political unit who are prominent in the past. I mean, our political editor was a former chairman of the Young Conservatives, but that was 30 years ago. Another one was a Lib Dem official or Lib Dem activist and so forth. There are a lot of those kinds of things around, so people can change. Obviously, it doesn't help trust if they're flipping and flopping in the way that you say, but I mean, I don't know the system, so I can't comment in detail on it. Just on a couple of other things briefly. The press agency that's just repeating quotes from the government, well, it's not a press agency, is it? So it needs to find, or people need to find a proper press agency, unless that's just, if that's the culture you work in, then journalists haven't got much hope unless somebody's going to change that, because a press agency, by definition, has got to be taking alternative views and putting out some sort of balanced views. If you're going to be just putting out the government line, then you may as well be your public information officer or whatever, or be a government press officer. Another gentleman was talking about readers and viewers don't punish us. How could they punish us in your system? They don't have another political party like UKIP, something outside the political establishment to go to. How would your readers and viewers, how do you define it? How, in what way? They stop viewing and they stop reading. But if they've got no alternative media sources, how are they supposed to know whether what, I mean, if there's great cynicism and very low voter turnout, then I could understand that. But I think your voter turnout in this country is far, far higher than ours at 60%. I think yours is much more substantial. And it's huge. There's huge concern and disillusion in Britain about politics, and that's why you have the whole anti-party movement, the reaction against the main parties, the rise of UKIP. That's one factor. I don't know the answer to that. You talk about no press release being put out because of the GDP figures. Why would you want a press release? That's what journalists are for. You've got the figures. Do the research. You don't need a press release to tell you the answer to that, surely.
You're getting it wrong. You don't go through a substantial revision of definitions. That's what I did. I wrote it, and I did the research myself. But it took someone basically looking into the statistics to come up with something of profound public interest. And the services that were in charge of letting the public know that our GDP turned out to be almost 10% higher than we thought didn't do anything about it. We had to discover it. We had to go through the details. We had to talk to Eurostat to go through the definitions, which changed drastically. And we had to get technical information from somebody else.
Well, why isn't your government blowing its own trumpet when it's got good news is the question, obviously. I mean, obviously, you want to be after them when there's bad news, but when there's good news, that's the government's job, as you're saying.
The same point is valid whether it's good news or bad news.
Well, you can expect the government not to be giving you press releases about bad news unless they can spin it in a way that becomes good news. But obviously, if they've got good news, I'm sure Alex would agree the government would be making a big deal and making sure everybody knew about it.
Right. We've got three more minutes before we have to hand back. So have we got some questions on this side? Very bright and intelligent people on this side of the room. So who wants to ask a question? Otherwise, we will have to. Any more questions? Yes, we got a question at the front, and then my colleague wants to go to the lady at the back.
I want to know, as a member of civil society, I want to know how you as the media can become more inclusive. The voices are there. There are a lot of voices. They're strong voices. They're educated voices. There's a definite right and wrong in what we are doing. What are we doing wrong and our voices not being heard?
Yeah.
How can you be more inclusive?
Yeah.
Hello, my name is Miriam Toniadu, a former journalist and actually former Cyprus news agency journalist and a Brussels correspondent as well. Over the past years, I've turned to communications and I've become a communications trainer and doing it for the EU. There's two, three points I want to point out. One is, I believe, well, until recently, until I knew about 2 years ago, the Cyprus government never had a communications strategy. To me, that shows if you don't have a communication strategy, it shows that you do not take it seriously and you do not understand basic principles of transparency, accountability, and democracy. That's one issue. I wonder if this has changed today and with the new government. The second point I wanted to make is it's high time that the Press and Information Office, and I know a lot of people working there and a lot of people who are excellent professionals, the government takes advantage of them and actually gives it a role and a say and looks into how the PIO works and what its role should be today. And then thirdly, because there was also mention of code of conducts, I'd like to say that the European Union does have a code of conduct for the people working for the Commission, and they could be a good starting point for Cyprus as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you for all those points. Mrs. Gavrilidou, has it changed? I mean, has this...
It's changing in the sense that, yes, we do have a more overview of what is happening and what the direction of the government is. It is not easy as yet, it's the government spokesman will tell you as well, to coordinate the ministries so that we have the ideal that Alex has there, that the government communication service speaks for the whole of the government and the picture is clear for the whole of the government at all points. This ministry does this, that belongs to the whole. This does this, that belongs to the whole. It's all in the same story. We are not there yet, but we are a lot further than we used to be.
Can I go to your left, to Stephen, who has done some work with reform for the government. Can I have your take on it? And
I think, you know, the new evolution of communication is changing the way in which governments speak to their public. There's a lot more in terms of dialogue and conversation, some of the examples we saw earlier. And so, you know, some of the evidence that I've seen is definitely moving in that direction. I think, you know, last year I did a lot of work in the Middle East, and there, you know, the government information offices, their main job, as far as I could work out, was send out pictures of people shaking hands with each other. You know, so-and-so met the ambassador of that, and His Highness met the president of this. And that seemed to be the main job of sending out photos of people shaking hands and, you know, having cups of tea. And I think, you know, the way in which government communications is going is beyond that, because that's kind of not really of interest to the audience. It's more about what I was talking about earlier, making the boss look good. And I think we see a lot of evidence, you know, both from my experience in the UK, but also internationally and here in Cyprus, of that dialogue, that conversation, that opening up the debate becoming more and more common. And, you know, some countries are moving at different paces in that. And frankly speaking, there are some large corporations who are moving at different paces in that. So it's not just an issue for governments or public sector, it's an issue for all large organizations who want to communicate with their stakeholders.
Thank you. Robert, yes, of course.
Two very brief points. To pick up what you were saying over here, I think the whole us and them of communicators, journalists, giving stuff out to the public is changing. Social media, there's much more access through the internet, through social media like Twitter and so forth. And in Britain, e-petitions is a thing. It's still quite small, but as Alex will be able to tell you far more than me, people are actually being able to influence what's discussed in the House of Commons and to show the strength of public feeling by signing up to e-petitions. I mean, it's a small thing, but these kinds of things are changing. The balance of us here giving out the news to you, it's changing. I mean, people are doing their own blogs. There's all sorts of independent media that can put it out there on YouTube, on Twitter, and so forth. So it's no longer us and them. It's changing, and it's slowly changing, but it is changing. So the public does become more empowered. And the second thing I'll just say very briefly, someone over here was talking about everybody knows everybody. It's a very small core. Well, in a vague way, you could say it was a bit like that in the old days when the BBC, before ITV came along. The BBC was very deferential to the government. It needed a new television company to come along and start asking tough questions, to do journalism in a different way, to give some distance from the politicians. Before there was that change which I was speaking about, there has to be a distance. Otherwise, there is this cozy conspiracy, and it doesn't do any good for journalism because you're not actually standing back and saying, well, okay, I know him and I like him, but what's he doing? Is it moral, et cetera, et cetera?
Yeah. Well, the tough questions are being asked. I mean, the social media, the younger generation, the civil society is now the ITV, and it is asking those questions, and it's a matter of actually listening to them and incorporating that on the agenda. Can I give the floor to you for a concluding comment before we go to the government spokesman and just keep this rather tight?
I think this has been a fascinating debate, and I'd endorse the points that were particularly made by Robert about the absolute ongoing value and fundamental importance to free societies of free media. What Stephen said about putting the humanity, the public, back into public relations is critical. But we know in the UK a bit about the future, the real future of communications, because we've just been through a referendum on the future of part of our country. And you one day may face a referendum on the future of your country. Again, something that Robert alluded to. And what we learned from that was three things. First, in that sort of intense political debate, all communications is digital, and the power of Facebook and the power of YouTube really came to the fore in that campaign. Remember, the Scottish Nationalists, the people who wanted separation, got 45% of the vote, and they had the support of one of perhaps 200 newspapers in the country, because they focused on the digital. Second, the ability of the Scottish Nationalist Party to win the stakeholders, the community leaders, the third sector we heard about earlier, That was the second part of their plan. And third, and we haven't talked at all about this today, the Scottish Government made sure all the civil servants who worked for them and to the civil servants in the room understood what the purpose of the Scottish Government was about. So digital, stakeholders, and internal communications were three lessons that were deployed to great effect as just a technical exercise by the Scottish Government and the Scottish Nationalist Party in the election.
I can't resist not asking this question because you raised the Scottish referendum. The government was accused of coming late or realizing late how close it was going to be, because the initial polls showed that it was going to be comfortable. But a couple of weeks before, it was understood that Downing Street became more mobilized in the communications field. Is that true? Can we understand why it came?
Yeah, I can. I don't wish to detain us, but very, very briefly. One, as a government, we to some extent stood back because there was a no campaign and a yes campaign. So those civil society campaigns with the political parties on either side were a large part of the debate. The job of the government and me as Director of Government Communications is to put information into the public arena, because the policy of the government support the our union to do that. I've illustrated how the Yes campaign were very sharp in their approach, and that influenced the debate. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, the campaign for the union, supported by HM government but led by the No campaign, was successful. So I'd just be a bit cautious about, you know, learning too much from a campaign that was innovative but ultimately was unsuccessful.
Thank you. Thank you very much for following us. And can I give the floor to the government spokesman for the concluding remarks? I think it's best if we remain seated rather than.
Νομίζω το κύριο συμπέρασμα του σεμιναρίου είναι ότι η επικοινωνιακή μας πολιτική δεν είναι πετυχημένη. Δεν θα χρησιμοποιήσω τη λέξη αποτυχημένη, αλλά δεν είναι πετυχημένη, είναι γεγονός. Εξάλλου γι' αυτόν κάναμε το συνέδριο. Γνωρίζουμε ότι υπάρχουν δυσκολίες, υπάρχουν προβλήματα, γι' αυτό θα κάνουμε το παν να βελτιωθούμε. Να ευχαριστήσω πάνω απ' όλα τον ΥΠΑ, τον Αρμοστή, για αυτήν τη συνεργασία. Το γεγονός ότι το κάνουμε μαζί είναι και επικοινωνιακό σε σχέση με το Ηνωμένο Βασίλειο, αλλά και για λόγους ουσίας εμείς θεωρούμε ότι υπάρχουν πολλοί τομείς οι οποίοι μπορούμε να συνεργαστούμε μαζί. Ένα ήθελα να αναφέρω, κλείνοντας κάποιες ιδέες που μου ήρθαν ακούγοντας τους ομιλητές. Το πρώτο είναι η ανάγκη για συνεχή επανασχεδιασμό της επικοινωνιακής σου πολιτικής. Εγώ θεωρώ πολύ δύσκολο να ξεκινήσει μια κυβέρνηση, να έχει μια επικοινωνιακή πολιτική και να μπορεί να πει ότι θα ακολουθήσω αυτή την επικοινωνιακή πολιτική τα επόμενα 5 χρόνια. Θεωρώ ότι αυτό θα είναι μια συνταγή αποτυχίας για την όποια κυβέρνηση. Κάτι άλλο που είναι σημαντικό, ειλικρινά εγώ προσπαθώ πάρα πολύ να το κάνω όσον αφορά τις δικές μου. Η κυβέρνηση έχει υποχρέωση να παρουσιάζει την πραγματική εικόνα. Είναι πολύ σημαντικό σήμερα που η πολιτική και με ΙΤΑ και με ΟΜΙΚΡΟΙΟΤΑ περνούν μεγάλη κρίση αξιοπιστίας από τον κόσμο. Είναι μεγάλο λάθος να θεωρείς ότι μπορείς να ξεγελάσεις τον κόσμο με να τον παρουσιάσεις μια ψεύτικη εικόνα. Ο κόσμος και η κοινωνία είναι πολλά πιο μπροστά από τους πολιτικούς. Και αν θέλει όποια κυβέρνηση να κερδίσει την κοινωνία, έστω την ανοχή της κοινωνίας, πρέπει να μιλά και να λέει την αλήθεια. Όσο δύσκολο και αν είναι κάποιες στιγμές, μια κυβέρνηση δεν μπορεί να πετυχαίνει σε όλους τους στόχους. Δεν είναι εφικτό να πετύχει σε όλους τους στόχους. Άρα έχει υποχρέωση να λέει την αλήθεια. Πρέπει να πω όμως την ίδια υποχρέωση έχουν και τα μέσα μαζικής ενημέρωσης. Έχουν ακριβώς την ίδια υποχρέωση, ίσως και μεγαλύτερη από την κυβέρνηση, γιατί είναι ήδη που παρουσιάζουν παίρνουν το μήνυμα, αν θέλετε, στον κόσμο, άρα έχουν την ίδια υποχρέωση. Κάτι άλλο είναι το γεγονός ότι μια είδηση σήμερα, ένα γεγονός, μεταδίδεται αμέσως. Στο παρελθόν μπορούσε η κυβέρνηση να έχει χρόνο να σκεφτεί μέχρι να βγει, πώς να το παρουσιάσω, πώς να αντιδράσω. Σήμερα δεν υπάρχει αυτή η πολυτέλεια. Άρα προκύπτει ανάγκη για άμεση αντίδραση από την κυβέρνηση και πλέον όχι μόνο με τις ανακοινώσεις, τα ανακοινωθέντα τύπου. Τα σύγχρονα μέσα τεχνολογίας πρέπει να τα αξιοποιούμε. Κάτι άλλο, το γεγονός ότι μια είδηση σήμερα δεν μπορεί να βγει μόνο από την κυβέρνηση ή τα μέσα μαζικής ενημέρωσης. Ο πολίτης μπορεί ανά πάσα στιγμή να βγάλει μια είδηση. Άρα οφείλουν όσοι ασχολούνται με τα μέσα μαζικής ενημέρωσης να παρακολουθούν τον πολίτη. Γι' αυτό αναφέρα προηγουμένως στα σχόλια. Είναι πολύ σημαντικά πώς αντιλαμβάνεται μια είδηση. Μπορεί η κυβέρνηση να θεωρεί ότι επέτυχε η πιο μεγάλη επιτυχία, ένα μέσο να την παρουσιάζει ως την πιο μεγάλη επιτυχία, αλλά διαβάζοντας τα σχόλια από κάτω τον κόσμο, να είναι για τον κόσμο η μεγαλύτερη αποτυχία. Το τι πιστεύει η κυβέρνηση ότι είναι επιτυχία ή μια εφημερίδα τι πιστεύει ότι είναι κάτι επιτυχία για την κυβέρνηση, δεν σημαίνει ότι για τον κόσμο είναι επιτυχία. Γι' αυτό πρέπει να διαβάζουμε τα σχόλια του κόσμου. Μπορώ να σας πω, ο πρόεδρος, η Μαρία είναι εδώ. Ο πρόεδρος έμαθε πλέον, οπότε υπάρχει ένα σημαντικό γεγονός. Θέλει να του τυπώνουμε τα σχόλια, να βλέπει, και αν διαβάνεστε στον πρόεδρο, τα σχόλια είναι σαν εμάς που είναι 3-4 σχόλια, μπορεί να σχολιάσουν 200 άτομα. Και θέλει πλέον να τα διαβάζει και επηρεάζεται. Και νομίζω είναι το πιο σωστό κριτήριο για να αντιληφθείς αν κάτι που επιδιώξες το πέτυχες ή όχι. Ένα άλλο θέμα που πρέπει να δούμε, εγώ νομίζω σε αυτό το σεμινάριο έπρεπε να ήταν και πολιτική. Μπορεί για τους πολιτικούς να ήταν πιο χρήσιμο. Η πολλή δημοσιότητα σημαίνει ότι είναι πάντα καλό. Έχουμε ένα θέμα για παράδειγμα. Στην Κύπρο είμαστε όλοι, δεν είναι κακό να κάνουμε αυτοκριτική, και τα κόμματα και η κυβέρνηση γενικότερα, παραγωγή ανακοινώσεων τύπου, μιλάω ένας, πρέπει να απαντήσουμε, μετά να ξαναπαντήσει. Εγώ νομίζω ότι η συντριπτική πλειοψηφία του κόσμου θεωρεί σοβαρό την ανακοινώση και να απαντούμε σε ανακοινώσεις. Είναι τούτο που θέλει η κοινωνία. Δηλαδή, μέσα από τις ανακοινώσεις να πούμε την ωραία ατάκα που να παίξει τη νύχτα στις ειδήσεις, να μπει την άλλη μέρα στις εφημερίδες, να το δούμε, να θεωρήσουμε ότι είναι καλό. Εγώ θεωρώ ότι ο κόσμος περιπέζει μας. Γι' αυτό πρέπει να είμαστε ιδιαίτερα προσεκτικοί πότε μιλούμε, γιατί μιλούμε και πώς μιλούμε. Τα νέα μέσα κοινωνικής δικτύωσης. Εγώ είδα πόσο σημαντική ήταν με την εμπειρία στην Προεδρία στις Βρυξέλλες. Δεν υπήρχε δημοσιογράφος που ασχολείται με τα μέσα κοινωνικής δικτύωσης. Αλλά να συμφωνήσω ότι υπάρχουν και περιορισμοί στα μέσα κοινωνικής δικτύωσης. Δηλαδή να βγει μια είδηση, αλλά η σοβαρή ανάλυση, εις βάθος ανάλυση που θέλει ο κόσμος, δεν μπορεί να την πάρει μέσα από τα μέσα κοινωνικής δικτύωσης. Τούτη είναι η εντύπωση δική μου, μπορεί να είμαι λάθος. Ένα άλλο πράγμα που είδα στις Βρυξέλλες είναι ποιος χειρίζεται. Δηλαδή, ένας πολιτικός μπορεί να έχει Twitter ή Facebook. Είναι σημαντικό όμως να είναι το προσωπικό του στίγμα. Γιατί δεν μπορεί να περιπέξει τον κόσμο ότι είναι ο πολιτικός που γράφει κάποια πράγματα. Και στο τέλος της ημέρας τούτο μπορεί να γυρίσει εναντίον του πολιτικού. Δηλαδή, πρέπει να χειρίζεσαι ή με κάποιον τρόπο να φαίνεται ότι είσαι εσύ που χειρίζεσαι τον λογαριασμό σου, είτε στο Twitter είτε στο Facebook. Είναι μέσα στο πλαίσιο της ότι πρέπει να είμαστε ειλικρινείς με τον κόσμο. Ένα άλλο θέμα που αντιμετωπίζουμε εμείς και προέκυψε από τις συζητήσεις, απαντούμε σε όλα τα δημοσιεύματα. Δηλαδή, κάθε μέρα έχουμε 8-9 εφημερίδες. Εγώ διαβάζω στο πρωί, πολλές φορές βλέπουμε, κάθε μέρα βλέπουμε πολλά πράγματα που ενισχύουν. Είτε κριτική προς την κυβέρνηση, είτε περιγραφή γεγονότων. Μπαίνεις στο διάλογο να απαντήσεις, είτε με ανακοίνωση, είτε με επιστολή, είτε να πάρεις τηλέφωνο τον δημοσιογράφο. Ποια είναι η σωστή στρατηγική? Εγώ δεν πήρα απάντηση στο ερώτημα τούτο σε σχέση με επικοινωνιακή στρατηγική. Πώς το χειρίζουμε τα θέματα αυτά? Δεν μπορεί να γράψει κάποιος κάτι, αν το παίξουν και στα ραδιόφωνα το πρωί, μπορεί να το παίξουν το μεσημέρι, να το δεις και το βράδυ στις ειδήσεις. Πώς το χειρίζεσαι, που το πρωί να απαντάς, ένα απαντάς, αν απαντήσεις μπορεί να γίνει πιο μεγάλο θέμα. Άρα, πού μπαίνει τούτο στην επικοινωνιακή στρατηγική? Υπάρχει σωστή πρακτική, λαθασμένη? Άρα έρχομαι στο θέμα που έθεσε ο Άλεξ. Πόσο εφικτό είναι να έχεις μια συγκροτημένη, καθορισμένη κυβερνητική στρατηγική επικοινωνίας? Τουλάχιστον στην Κύπρο. Είμαι σίγουρος ότι στη Βρετανία υπάρχουν τόσα πρόπτα κάθε μέρα. Το πρωί που ξυπνάς, ξέρεις τι να σου ξημερώσει. Ξέρω ότι οι επαγγελματίες της επικοινωνιακής στρατηγικής θα συμφωνήσουν μαζί μου, αλλά πρέπει να δούμε τούτον το απρόπτο και πώς το χειρίζεσαι. Και πάλι δεν υπάρχει συνταγή για το απρόπτο μέσα στην επικοινωνιακή στρατηγική. Εξαρτάται τι είναι το απρόπτο εκείνο. Ούτε θέλω Θέλω να σχολιάσω, αλλά ας πούμε το τι έγινε στο Μαρί. Ποιος μπορεί να πει, ποιος είναι ο σωστός επικοινωνιακός επικοινωνιακή αντίδραση της κυβέρνησης. Εγώ θεωρώ ότι αν καθίσουν να συζητήσουν πέντε του κλάδου επαγγελματίες, μπορεί να μην συμφωνήσουν στο τέλος της ημέρας. Ή έναν απρόπτο που γίνεται. Είναι πράγματα που πρέπει να δούμε. Ένα άλλο θέμα που αυτό που ανέφερε ο Άλεξ αφορούν σε κάποιο βαθμό αφορούσαν τη βρετανική εμπειρία. Δεν ξέρω πόσο μπορούμε να πούμε ότι μπορούμε να ακολουθήσουμε το βρετανικό παράδειγμα στην Κύπρο ή το γαλλικό παράδειγμα. Η κάθε χώρα έχει τις ιδιαιτερότητες της. Και πρέπει να προσαρμόζεται η επικοινωνιακή στρατηγική στις, σε ένα άλλο θέμα με αφορμή αυτό. Πρέπει να έχει μια επικοινωνιακή στρατηγική για το εσωτερικό και μια επικοινωνιακή στρατηγική για το εξωτερικό. Ειδικά για μια χώρα όπως την Κύπρο, που έχει πολιτικό πρόβλημα, ή το θέμα της οικονομίας το Μάρτιο του 2013, ξαφνικά η Κύπρος έγινε το μεγάλο θέμα στις ευρωπαϊκές πρωτεύουσες, ενώ μέχρι τότε ανεγράφουμε για την Κύπρο, ήταν για το πολιτικό πρόβλημα. Άρα πρέπει να δούμε μια στρατηγική για το εσωτερικό και μια για σε διεθνές επίπεδο, ακόμα σε ευρωπαϊκό και άλλο σε άλλες χώρες. Πολύ όρθιη η διαπίστωση και του Άλεξ ότι ο κόσμος είναι να εμπιστευτεί περισσότερο ότι γράφει ένα στο ίντερνετ παρά τι λέει η κυβέρνηση. Πρέπει να το έχουμε υπόψη μας αυτό. Για τα πρόπτα το έχω αναφέρει. Εκείνο που είπε πάλι ο Άλεξ, νομίζω ανάφερε η Ελεονόρα, είναι πολύ σημαντικό. Δεν το κάνουμε στην Κύπρο, τώρα αρχίζουμε να το κάνουμε. Πρέπει να αξιολογούμε τη δουλειά μας. Και η αξιολόγηση δεν είναι μόνο να ανέφερε αποτελέσματα, αλλά η αξιολόγηση είναι μέσα από τα σχόλια του κόσμου. Αν ο κόσμος τούτα που σου γράφει που κάτω σημαίνει αντιλήφθηκε το μήνυμα που ήθελες να του δώσεις. Γιατί υπάρχουν και άλλου είδους αξιολογήσεις, δημοσκοπήσεις, αλλά πράγματα έχω τους ενδιασμούς μου, αλλά θεωρώ ότι τα σχόλια του κόσμου είναι η πρώτη αξιολόγηση στις ενέργειες της κυβέρνησης. Για τους εκπροσώπους τύπου των Υπουργείων, το έχω αναφέρει πριν. Η διαπίστωση του Στίβεν, απόλυτα σωστή, πρέπει να ξέρουμε ποιο είναι το ακροατήριό μας. Δηλαδή, μπορεί να βγάλουμε μια ανακοίνωση σε όποια θέση να είμαστε, να ικανοποιήσουμε τον προϊστάμενο μας, να του άρεσε πάρα πολλά, γιατί... Αλλά στο τέλος της ημέρας, το μήνυμα να μην πιένει για μένα που ήθελες. Άρα, γράφοντας ή μιλώντας δημόσια, πρέπει να σκέφτεσαι σε ποιον μιλάς, σε ποιον απευθύνεσαι και όχι ας σε ακούσει κάποιος αν τα είπες καλά ή αν θα ικανοποιήσεις τον ίδιο. Human to human communication, είπε ο Στίβεν, πάλι θεωρώ πολύ, πολύ σημαντικό να σέβεσαι αυτούς που μιλάς, να θεωρείς ότι είναι πιο έξυπνοι από σένα και αντιλαμβάνονται απόλυτα και μπορούν να διαβάσουν και πέρα από αυτά που τους λες. Μόνο έτσι μπορείς να κερδίσεις, όχι να τους κερδίσεις να περάσεις τις θέσεις σου, αλλά τουλάχιστον να σε σεβαστούν ότι μπορεί να διαφωνούν μαζί σου, αλλά πιστεύει πραγματικά αυτά τα πράγματα. Λοιπόν, το άλλο που σχετίζεται με τα δεδομένα σε κάθε χώρα, πρέπει να γνωρίζεις απόλυτα το πλαίσιο το οποίο λειτουργείς. Για την Κύπρο, μια χώρα μικρή και με τα υφιστάμενα οικονομικά προβλήματα, πρέπει να αξιοποιούμε όλα τα διαθέσιμα μέσα και τις νέες μορφές τεχνολογίας. Είναι σημαντικό να τις αξιοποιούμε. Για την στρατηγική επικοινωνία σε περιόδους κρίσης έχω αναφερθεί. Κάτι που αφορά την Κύπρο. Εγώ, χωρίς καμιά διάθεση κριτικής, αλλά η συντριπτική πλειοψηφία των δημοσιογράφων στην Κύπρο, ειδικά στα ραδιόφωνα και στις τηλεοράσεις, δεν είναι εξειδικευμένοι. Δεν μπορεί να καλύπτουν το Κυπριακό, την ανεργία, την οικονομία, τη γεωργία. Τούτον το πράγμα, αντιλαμβάνεστε ότι δημιουργεί προβλήματα ακόμα και στο επίπεδο του κόσμου που θέλει να περάσει μηνύματα. Είναι ένα γεγονός που στο εξωτερικό δεν υπάρχει. Στην Κύπρο έχουμε το φαινόμενο. Οι δημοσιογράφοι να ασχολούνται με όλα τα θέματα. Λοιπόν, αυτά. Ευχαριστήσω πάρα πολύ τους, όλους τους συμμετέχοντες. Είναι σίγουρο ότι εμείς θα κάνουμε με την Ελεονόρα και τους άλλους συναδέλφους το homework μας. Ελπίζουμε σύντομα να κάνουμε ένα νέο συνέδριο, να σας παρουσιάσουμε τη στρατηγική μας. Ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Ευχαριστούμε τον κυβερνητικό εκπρόσωπο και όλους εσάς για την εδώ παρουσία σας. Ακολουθεί η δεξίωση.